Let's pray and we'll get to the word and see what God has in store for us today. What's up, Robbie? Heavenly Father, thank you so much. We just thank you because you are a God who listens. You are a God who knows. You are a God who speaks. You enter into time and space. You've done so with your Son, and now you do so through your Holy Spirit and the preaching of your word to convict and to console and to move. And Lord, we just ask you to lead us today by your Holy Spirit, that we would know you and your love in a deeper way. Lord, you give us victory. You make it certain, and that our future is secure. And from that and from your love for us, we are persuaded and moved to live a life accordingly. And I just ask you that you would be the center in this time, and that all the other voices go away, and that we might just focus on you and you alone. Lord, that my sins and my defects as a man would in no way hamper your perfect message of grace that you have for us through your scripture this morning. And Lord, we ask this all in the name of Jesus. Amen. So this morning I'm going to talk about something that I really don't know too much about. I tried to learn over watching TED Talks and everything like that, but it was kind of above my pay grade. So I'm going to use just a commonality. I mean, we're all in this together, and I asked people today as they were coming in the same question, and everyone responded affirmatively. So I'm 10 for 10. So I think I can bring us all into this. Do you ever talk to yourself? Yeah, right. I guess the question is, do you ever stop talking to yourself? There's a whole study of this, and this is where it gets a little bit above my pay grade, but it's called private speech, and they've done research on this, and talking to yourself helps you concentrate, all right, and it keeps you focused. It also helps you to process things, and they've even done some interesting things that if you, and this sounds really weird, but if you talk to yourself in the third person, you actually have a different perspective of what you're going through if you're talking in the first person, which I'll touch back on in a second. But the main point is, and what I really want to talk about today, is we have a conversation going a lot. This week, I received a text from someone, and verbatim, it was bullet marked, 1, 2, 3. It says, I have zero control in my life. Shopping, food, exercise, no discipline, just floating. How's that conversation going? All right? Can you imagine how that's working? You know, as you walk into the store, or you walk by the donuts, or you walk by this, and you're just floating, and there's nothing to stand on, there's no rock, there's nothing. There was another one who told me, I'm just tired. Have you ever, you've said that to yourself? Oof. I'm just tired. Well, we have to be real careful when we're talking to ourselves, because we're going to look today that this conversation can be damaging or it can be leading, and depending on what you're saying and who you're talking to. So let me just put it into context. We've been discussing over the past weeks a really closely tight-knit argument in chapter 8 of Romans. And the great theme of Romans is this absolute security and centrality that of our salvation through faith. And we looked at our union with Christ, and we looked at that the first sermon was, there's no condemnation, there's no guilt, there's no shame, there's newness of life. And then we talked about the next section was the indwelling of the Holy Spirit within us, and we looked at there's no separation between justification and sanctification. It's like a BOGO. You buy one, get one. I mean, you can't separate it. You get them both. You can't say, I'm forgiven, but I live the life I want to live. Why? Because you receive the Holy Spirit, and you have the Holy Spirit indwelling. Last week, we looked at this practical exhortation about putting to death the sins of the body. And it wasn't just passive. It said, actually, you do it by the power of the Holy Spirit. And so we're active in this process. And now we can't take it out of context, but we have this next verse and we're going to look at it. It's chapter 8 in your pew Bibles, or it will be on the screen. So it's only one verse and it's quite short. So I should get you out of here, you know, by one. So look what it says here in chapter 8, verse 14. Now, when we see that word for, it means it's a continuation of the argument. And so it says, for all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. That's it. All those who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. Now, that's not for everyone. It's just sons of God who are the ones who are led. And now we're going to enter in this theme. And the theme is our security by justification of faith. And we've talked about the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. But now we're going to actually talk about the indwelling Holy Spirit giving what? Sonship and status and adoption next week. And we're going to see that we become family. Our status changes. We were once orphaned and separated, and now we're brought to the banquet table and loved and accepted as true sons and daughters of the living King. And so that's the key as we follow the argument. Now, most people take this section and for the last, I would say, 100 years, they put sanctification first. All right, because we're so subjective and it's all about us and we have a real myopic view, church really becomes about sanctification. How can my life be better? Right? And it really becomes all about me. I need this to be fixed. How can I stop this addiction? How can I do this? How can I do that? And it really starts to be a moralistic, therapeutic kind of add God into it therapy for me to be better. Paul never starts with sanctification. He doesn't even deal with it. In chapter 8, verse 30, we're not going to go there. I'll just tell you. You can look it up later. But he says, those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also what? Glorified. He even skips over sanctification because it's included, but that's not the important part. The important part is what God is doing in you first. We've put the cart before the horse. And there'll be no sanctification unless you understand the gospel and justification by faith. There's no sanctification unless you understand your sonship and that you're belonging and you're loved and accepted and nothing can separate you from that. There's no sanctification without identity. So Paul is talking a lot about the certainty and the security of our identity first, and it works itself out into sanctification. Now, what he's talking about here is not only we're forgiven, but we have this change of position. It's a change of nature, and we use this word rebirth, or born again, or born of the Spirit, or born of God, or we're in Christ. And we just sang about the victory of the world, but in of itself, faith does not save you without what? Being born again. All right, but they come together because in James it says even the demons believe, right? But they believe in a God. They don't believe his word and believe God. And what happens is we can't separate this. If you believe in Jesus Christ, you are what? Born again. You're given a new heart. You're given a new mind. In John 3:3, Jesus says only those who are born again can enter what? The kingdom of God. And today, I hate to say it, but church, and I'm talking church in general, we're not putting enough emphasis on this supernatural thing that happens and occurs in us and through us by the power of the Holy Spirit. It's become, you know, assent to a few things, come to church, eat a donut, and we consider you a brother. But becoming something, transformation, once I was this and now it's different. And we need to see this in a real way. So let's talk about sons first. The older I get, and I don't know if this is a good thing or not, if you have the same experience, the older you get, you see your dad more and more, or you see your mom more and more, and you say, oh, you know, I said I'd never become my dad, but guess what? I am. I mean, my fingernails look like them. You know what I mean? But there's a certain DNA that just you start to look like your what? Your father. Well, when we're born again, there's something special that occurs because guess what? I have an earthly mother and I have an earthly father, but now I have a what? A heavenly father. And I have to take on some similarity of who he is. Now, this includes behavior. Now, I understand that we're saved by faith alone, but if you want proof of that, then there has to be some kind of behavioral change. That's what we would call being born again. It's not a question of I have to. It's a question is that I want to. It doesn't, I got to go to church. We should be like, yes, I get to go to church. I have to serve my wife or my husband. No, you get to. Right? And no one liked that. I didn't get a lot of amens on that one. It was all good until then, right? Are you a son of God? Do you want proof? What's it look like? And this verse says, if you want proof, it says, those who are led by the Holy Spirit are sons of God. What does it mean to be led by the Holy Spirit? We have an interesting example in the Old Testament. Do you remember God is taking the people of Israel out of Egypt, right? And they end up in the wilderness, and he says, all right, I'm going to show you the way. Do you remember how he showed them the way? They had a column of fire during night, and there was a pillar of smoke during the day. And they saw that, and he said, and there were specific rules. He said, if you see the pillar of smoke or the pillar of fire move, you move. And if it doesn't, you stick. Well, that's really pretty cool. Now, you could say, well, I need a pillar of fire, right? And then it would, well, that's not how it works today. On a spiritual level, we have to still maintain ourselves in the context. Most people want to be told what's next. Where should I go? What should I take this job? Should I go here? Should I go that? No, right now he's really talking more, not about direction. He's talking about identity. Do you hear what I just said? In the context of what we're saying is last week it was put to death the sins of the body. All those who are led by the Holy Spirit are sons of God. And so the context is what? Being the person of God that you're supposed to be as born again is being led by the Holy Spirit. We're not talking whether you should wear a red shirt or a blue shirt or whether you should drive on the right side or the left side. No, that's not what we're talking about. We're saying the analogy would be is how is God taking you from bondage and slavery to the promised land? And we would rather just him to tell us where to go. But this is an inward movement of how he is purifying us. And so when I say this, I need to say this again. He leads us, which is passive, but he doesn't carry us. All right? Just like last week, through the power of the Holy Spirit, you put to death the sins of the body. Today I'm saying the same thing. Be led by the Holy Spirit, but that means you have to get up and what? Walk. Keep step with the Holy Spirit. You're involved in this. So the question is, how does this work? How does one get led by the Holy Spirit? That's the million-dollar question, right? Well, it's by persuasion. All right? Now, this is really important. Christianity never does violence to the will. It never forces the will. No one forces you to reject God. And when he gives you a new heart and a new mind, he changes your desire so that you choose who? Him. But there's a persuasion that goes on. Is a cause, an influence, a reasoning or argument, and it's never forced. You know, it says he's a small, still voice, right? You heard that one, right? And the Holy Spirit's kind of sensitive. Why? Because you can grieve the Holy Spirit, you can quench the Holy Spirit, and you can have the Holy Spirit scarring in the sense that he just pulls away. Now, it doesn't pull away for good. But he says, oh, you don't want to listen to me? I remember when I was talking to my dad one time, he would talk, and then as he's talking, you know, my eyes would roll in the back of my head, and he would say, don't shut me off. All right? And sometimes that's what we do, right? We don't want to hear it anymore, and we just shut it off. But this is where this conversation takes place, and it influences the heart and the mind. Now, there is one thing that constrains us, and Paul says what constrains us is the love of God. Let me just look at another verse. Let's look at Isaiah 30, verse 21. Isaiah chapter 30, verse 21. The Lord, the title here is the Lord will be gracious, and he's the people are disobedient, they're away. But look what it says in verse 21. It says, and your ears shall hear a word behind you, saying, this is the way, walk in it, when you turn to the right or when you turn to the left. And I love that word picture. There's a voice behind you who's going to confirm, is going to tell you whether you're walking the right path or not. What are you listening to? Who are you listening to? What voice are you listening to? And that will control your conversation. Now, I'm not saying everyone's hearing voices, all right? But there is a conversation going on in your head. That's 10 for 10. We're all going through it. And I know, because I do this, try to do the same, we all want to make the right choices. No one says, oh, I really want to go down a path that's a dead end. I really want to go, you know, down a path where there is no hope. I really want to go down the path of addiction. No one says, oh, I has his first drink and says, I can't wait until I'm an alcoholic. No one says that. And we have to be real careful, is because what we listen to or who we listen to in our head is really, really important, because I can't get in there. That's a private conversation, right? Only you know it. But is it the feelings, the desires, the urges, the hungers, the impulses, the instincts? Sometimes the conversation tries to rationalize sin and we respond like animals. We're guided by lust. We're guided by passions. Why do you do things? Well, everyone else is doing it. Why do you buy certain products? Why do you listen to this? Why do you hold certain views? Why do you do this? Is it all nurture? Is it nature? Is it society? And we're going to come up with these answers, and the conversation is going to be with four. The conversation is going to be with science, or culture, or self. And that's all subjective. The one I'm most worried about is self, because where the heart, I mean, the Bible says the heart is the most, you know, wicked thing. And if you get in a conversation with yourself, listen, you guys don't look it, but you are like Olympic gymnastic experts, because you can bend the truth, you can do whatever you need to take to make it fit. And we get into this conversation, and the question there is, why do you do what you do? Now, I am not saying you're going to be perfect, but I'm asking you, are you being led by the Holy Spirit? With all my faults, with all my failures, is it true in me? So this leading of the Spirit, now the Spirit is called the Spirit of Truth. And so to use the analogy, you know, we at Hope Chapel, we're like experts at that what's up group chat, right? So can you imagine a group chat? I mean, we have more group chats than groups, I think. I think we really do. But so a group chat, what's in a group chat is, if it was just between me and the Holy Spirit, it'd be an easier conversation, right? But people chime in with memes, right? Because something flies in through the internet. Some people, it will just be a bad comment. It might be something that the way someone looked at you. It might be traffic. It might be a fear. It might be anything. And everyone's just kind of chiming in. And it becomes kind of chaotic because of all these different voices coming into my group chat. And at the end of the day, it goes, what are we even talking about? Right? And the word, you know, And this is not non-biblical. This is a tip for you guys. You cannot solve the problem with a meme. All right? It simplifies things too much. You're a complicated person. Don't hold on to a meme. All right, but people will send it, and it's easy and everything like that. So we have this group chat, but the other spirits or the other people in the chat are false and they're evil. And it would have you do what you're not supposed to do and to shut down the Holy Spirit. And so we have to be really concerned because he says, prove the spirits, test the spirits, discern the spirits. Are those spirits, is it coming from the world? Is it coming from the self? Is it coming from the devil? How do we know? Isn't that the key? People say, Pastor, how do I know? How do I know what's right? How do I know what I should do? The Spirit of Truth uses one thing, which is the Bible. This is the standard. This is it. Now, this is not rocket science. I say this every time. Now I'm going to be a little confrontational. If you are led by the Holy Spirit, you are a son of God. If you are led by the Holy Spirit, you need to know the standard. If you're not in the Word, it's going to be very difficult to be led by the what? Holy Spirit. Well, I have my experience. Don't trust it. I know my facts. Don't trust it. I know science. Be careful. Society says this. You know, Abraham Lincoln said that 95% of the things on internet is true. You get that? All right? Listen, just because it's on the internet does not make it true. Just because it flies into the group chat doesn't make it true. We've got to judge it by this. And I have heard craziness. I've heard people having affairs and saying, we're going to pray about this affair as I'm cheating on my husband or wife so God blesses it. Is that of God? No, that's gymnastics. That's craziness. But we'll do it every time we have a chance. What are we listening to? Scripture alone. Do not add to it. Do not take it away. It's not about your experience. It's not about your tradition. Look at what it says in Ephesians chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17 through 20. Look at this. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation and the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your heart enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you and to the riches of his glory and inheritance in the saints, and what is immeasurable greatness of his power towards us who believe, according to the workings of his great might, that he worked in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him on the right hand in heavenly places. He gives you wisdom. People ask me, Lord, I need to know. Open your Bible. Listen, this is the living Word of God. It answers questions that you need to know. Listen, I don't have a magic Bible verse or a meme that's going to make this better. You find God in the truth of God through the Spirit of God, which is in His Word. Now, I can't say that enough. But we've got to examine yourself, because if you're led by the Holy Spirit, he's going to lead you to what? This. If you don't have a Bible, take one. Do you hear what I just said? If you don't have a Bible, take one. Leave with a Bible. And I'm not saying, don't say this, because everyone's, I'm going to read the Bible this week. No, you're not. You don't run a marathon just by starting out. Read it for 5 minutes. Get one Bible verse. Think of things that of God. Go to the men's Bible study. Go to the women's. Go to HIT. Go to Sunday school. Get involved. Be a part of a community. Be this. So it's interesting, but he says, I'm going to open your eyes and illuminate you and give you wisdom. And you know what it's all about? It's about who God is and the one who he has sent. It's about the gospel message. The Holy Spirit will teach you the gospel. He will teach you that you can't do it. He'll teach you that you're a sinner. He'll teach you that about Adam and you've inherited it, it's become part of your will, and you really try not to. The spirit's willing, but the what? Flesh is weak. I'm trying, Pastor. I'm trying to be better. I'm trying to be better. Dr. Phil says, how's that working for you? It's not. And then the price of sin is death, because God is glorious and holy and mighty, and it's not that I have a problem with God. It's that God has a problem with me. He can't accept me the way I am, and I try to be good enough, and I try, and that doesn't work because the standard is perfection, and he gives us his law, but we just sang about it, and it's great, and it was all silence, and then he came to earth running with mercy in his eyes, and he said, I'm going to solve this problem, and he sends his son, Jesus Christ, 100% man, so he knows you. Do you hear what I just said? He knows what you're feeling. He's 100% man, but he's also 100% God, perfect in all ways. And he goes and he dies for you as a sacrifice of atonement, which means he placates God's anger, pays for your sin, and then we are justified. But not only are we justified, redemption is we're justified and glorified all the way till the end. What he has started, he will finish. And he's going to remind you of that. The gospel changes the conversation. Do you hear what I just said? The gospel changes the conversation, because you can start the gospel as, well, I have no control over everything. Who has control? God does. Can I trust him? Oh, how do I know? Because he sent his son who loves you enough to die for you, so he'd give you a new heart and a new mind, so you'd have the Holy Spirit within you, so he'll never leave and forsake you. Oh, but I'm all alone, Pastor. Are you really all alone? Or is the Holy Spirit doing it? Oh, but I'm a failure. I said, I know you're a failure, but God doesn't see your failure. He sees who? Christ's success, his victory. Listen, the conversation goes dark if you stay in the bad news of the gospel. I'm no good. I'm guilty. I can't. I'm no good. I'm guilty. I'm shameful. I'm no good. I'm guilty. And you say that 100 times, it becomes your truth. But where's the gospel in that? You were that. But now, there's a righteousness from heaven who has changed all that. We've been transported from death to life. You know, there's a time for mourning. There's a time for fasting. But if you understand the gospel, it's the wedding feast. God conquered death through Jesus Christ. There's no longer any weapons of Satan against you. But the conversation has to be guided by who? The Holy Spirit. So where we go from here, and I'm just going to try to give you a few things, 5 things. And like I said, am I led by the Holy Spirit? I would like to say that I'm trying, all right? I have the Holy Spirit. But am I keeping step with him? So when I give you these things, I've put in the word increasing in, all right? Because there has to be some kind of increasement, or that's not even a word. I just made up a word. Just increase, all right? Sorry. We increase, all right? So here are the 5. If you want to know if you're led by the Spirit, here are the 5 things. And like I said, you're not going to be perfect, but this should be a pattern in your life. The first one is you should have an increasing outlook that is spiritual. Listen, if you don't like hanging around and talking about Jesus and what he's doing and the changes that he occurs and the greatest thing in the world and the church and missions, I say this to my kids all the time, if you entertain yourself by the world and listen to what the world listens to and parties like the world and dresses like the world, if it acts like a duck and walks like a duck, it's a what? A duck. We've got it. There's something different. We're not holding, and I tell people, we're gripping onto this life a little bit too tight. It's not about the stuff. It's not about the money. It's not about the career. We're on a pilgrimage. Our city is a different place. Our citizenship is in a different place. We're just passing through. Don't get locked in. Our view should be what? Eternal. Our view should be souls. the spiritual part of your neighbor, the spiritual part, the soul of your wife, the soul of your children. The eternal destiny, because we're not talking about just sanctification to make my life a little easier right now, to make it less complicated. We're talking about something greater than that. Look what it says in 1 Corinthians 2:12. 1 Corinthians 2:12. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit is who is from God, that we might understand the things freely given to us by God. Your spirit's not of this world. We have a different spiritual outlook. Next, an increasing desire to glorify God. This is an easy conversation. When you're about to do something, when you're confronted, when you're, what do you ask the question, is what I'm about to do God glorifying? Would he be pleased? Would people see me and say, God be the glory? And if the answer is no, what should you do? Not do it. That's being led by what? The Holy Spirit. Increasing in spiritual outlook, an increasing desire to glorify God. Look at this next one. Increasing desire to know God. I come back to the word. Listen, if you are going to have a relationship, and Hope Chapel is all about building relationships and reflecting love, and it's about relationship. God is a God of relationships, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. But to have a relationship with someone, you have to get to know them. All right? You've got to understand who they are, what they like, what their goals are, what their dreams are. You get to know someone, and when you get to know that person, there's an intimacy built. That's what you should be. What is Jesus doing? What does he want? What's his heart's desire? What would he have me do? Well, this whole book is about that. And there should be an increasing desire to know God. You know, this is eternal life, that you may know God and the one who he has sent. It's about knowing him. It's about a relationship with him. Next, and this is a really cool one, you'll have an increasing awareness of sin. It says in John 6:18 that the Spirit comes to convict the world of its sin. And when he comes, he will convict the world concerning the righteousness and judgment. Listen, you'll understand when you're not doing right and when you're not doing wrong. This will mean crazy. There's an increasing sensitivity to sin. You'll know your triggers. That little voice will start going beep, 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 beep. And you'll be like, uh-oh, I know I'm in the danger zone. I got to go. I got to do something. Now, you can do the gymnastics as you want, but there's the voice of God there, and it's whispering. It's not going to yell at you. It's not going to force you. It is saying, do you understand who I am, and do you love me? And then finally, increasing longing after holiness. You do mortify sin. You make no provisions of the faith. It's a zero tolerance policy. And that's what Jesus said. Jesus said, if your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. If your eye causes you to sin, pluck it out. It'd be better for you to go to heaven maimed than to not and have everything of your mortal body. No tolerance. I desire to glorify God. I desire to do this. And why? Because you've been given the Holy Spirit. Make no profession. And then finally, we have to manifest the fruit of the Holy Spirit, which is found in Galatians chapter 5, verse 22. And you guys know it. The fruit, which is one, it doesn't say fruits, right? So don't pick and choose which ones you want. All right? And part of the fruit is self-control. And, oh, I don't have self-control. I have no control over spending, food, exercise. That was it, right? I have no control over that. Wait a minute. I thought you had the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit's the third person of the Trinity, and it's all power and all glory, equal in power and glory as God the Father, God the Son, and you're saying you have no control? That conversation's wrong. See what I just said? The conversation's wrong. So where do we go from here? Listen, no one's got it down perfect. The only one who led a spirit-filled life perfectly is who? Jesus Christ. Someday we will, when we get to heaven, we'll be glorified, and that's so certain. But right now, you are being called to be led by the Holy Spirit to prove that you are sons of God. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just come and we just thank you because you are a God who knows us. You know our weaknesses. You know our strength, Lord. You work through the power of the Holy Spirit. It is what illuminates us, what shows us, what opens our eyes, Lord. And you work sovereignly, Lord. And I just ask right now, if there is someone here who does not know you in this way, that may have been in church for a long time but has never been born again, that the Holy Spirit would just come upon this person and open their eyes and see the reality of the beauty and the majesty of Jesus Christ. That they might understand that Jesus loved them enough to sacrifice himself, and the blood that he shed was to forgiveness of sin, and that there is no more shame and there is no more guilt. And we say it over and over again, if the Son frees you, you are free indeed. That they might live free, knowing that they're loved as children of the living God, and that is so secure that nothing can pluck you out of his hand. And that what he started in you, he will finish, and you are safe and you are secure. And it is so certain that nothing can separate us from the love of God, not powers and principalities, not the voices, nothing. We are yours and you are ours, and you're in us and we're in you. Holy Spirit, work supernaturally in our hearts. Give us the desire to follow you. Change our ways of thinking. We have the mind of Christ. That we would be your people and we would glorify you, and people would see our good works and glorify the Father, you. That our lives would be about you. You've given us the victory. You've defeated the devil. Now he just says, keep step with me. Glorify me. Glorify me through your families. Glorify me through your lives. Glorify me through your work. Glorify me in all times. Whether you eat or drink, glorify me. Lord, make it true that we would listen to the Holy Spirit, that we would study your word. And we ask this all in the precious, precious name of Jesus. Amen.